Good afternoon and welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. I'm Chelsea Foxwell, Associate Professor of Art History and East Asian Languages and Civilizations here at the University of Chicago. And I specialize in Japanese art history. We're so honored to have Dr. John Carpenter to kick off our symposium, Kabuki in Print, this weekend with his keynote lecture. I conceived this symposium inspired really by a bequest of Japanese prints, mainly focused on kamigata yakusha or kabuki prints from the Osaka area, from the Edo and Meiji periods, which really augmented the smart's existing holdings within kabuki prints. And as well as inspired by the wonderful colleagues that I knew at the University of Chicago and beyond, really wanting them to come and see the prints and help think about how we can further study and interpret them and hopefully exhibit them. So in this conference, we're going to be thinking about not only visual art that depicts kabuki, but also really how we can access kabuki through various media and try to imagine and reconstruct kabuki that was on stage in times past. So to introduce Dr. Carpenter today, it's my honor to introduce the Dana Feitler Director of the Smart Museum of Art, Dr. Vanya V. Malloy.
Thank you, Chelsea. Can everyone hear me okay? Yeah? Okay. I'm honored to be here with all of you today and delighted to have the great privilege of introducing our keynote speaker this afternoon, Dr. John T. Carpenter. Dr. Carpenter has been the Mary Griggs Burke Curator of Japanese Art at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City since 2011. He has published widely on Japanese art, especially in the areas of calligraphy, painting, and woodblock prints, and has developed and helped organize numerous exhibitions at the Met, some of which include Designing Nature, Brush Writing in the Arts of Japan, Celebrating the Arts of Japan, The Poetry of Nature, and In the Tale of Genji, a Japanese classic illustrated. His exhibitions at the Met have been extraordinarily important to the field, and very importantly, enthusiastically received by both scholars and the general public alike. And I have to know, I was a fellow at the Met at the same time as some of these shows, so I can attest to this. In addition to his exhibitions, Dr. Carpenter has shown great vision and an imagination in expanding the Met's holdings in Japanese art into new areas, including such areas as Nihonga. Prior to arriving at the Met, he was professor at the School of Oriental and African Studies at the University of London, where he was recognized for his outstanding scholarship on Japanese texts and images. He also served as head of the London office of the Sainsbury Institute for the Study of Japanese Art and Culture. As some of you may know, and as Chelsea mentioned, in 2015, the Smart Museum of Art acquired a gift of over 1,000 Japanese prints from the collection of the late Brooks McCormick Jr. A sizable number of these relate to kabuki. For this reason, I'm especially excited for Dr. Carpenter's keynote talk this afternoon entitled A Poetics of Inscribed Kabuki Actor Portraits. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Carpenter.
Thank you very much, Vanya, and thank you, Chelsea, for inviting me here to the Smart Museum and for making my stay so pleasant. When Chelsea first invited me to give a talk, she mentioned that Brooks McCormick collection was particularly strong in Osaka actor prints. And so I thought that I would talk exclusively on that subject about the poetic texts on prints such as you see here. But then, of course, these inscribed actor portraits of the Osaka tradition are drawing on a longer tradition that began in the early 18th century that have haikai, or what you refer to as haiku now, 17 syllable verse. And then there was a kyōka boom, the 31 syllable verse, witty verse that became all the rage in late 18th, early 19th century. And then you can't understand the Osaka tradition without realizing the incredible impact of Toyokuni and Kunisada and the entire Utagawa school, who had a near monopoly on actor prints in Edo. So when we get to the 19th century, we see this momentous explosion of deluxe quality prints, the brash, dynamic, brilliantly colored actor prints of mid-19th century kamigata or kansai. Just before coming over, some of us were very fortunate to be able to peruse the albums of prints from the McCormick collection, and I found particularly dazzling the Hirosada prints in pristine condition, preserved for a century in albums. So I'll lead up to that period through studying some of the background. I should mention at the outset that in my title, I use the word poetics, the art of writing poetry in the broadest sense, the study of the structure and the forms of Japanese poetry, both the 17th and 31 syllable varieties. But I also refer to poetics in the sense of understanding how a text's different elements come together and produce certain effects on the reader. And let's keep in mind and look at this as I show you these slides, that all of the inscriptions are inscribed in distinctive calligraphy. Sometimes it's calligraphy that's meant to replicate that of the poet himself or herself. Sometimes it's simply a professional calligrapher. Sometimes it's the artist's calligraphy. And most exceptionally and most interestingly for me is when the calligraphy replicates that of the actor himself. And I'll be showing you some manuscript calligraphy, the distinctive forms, the idiosyncratic forms of, for instance, Ichikawa Danjūrō VII, or in Osaka, the distinctive calligraphy of Rikan. I start at the very beginning with prints with no inscriptions at all, not even signed. I think this has to be by Torikionobu the first. And when we look at the print, we see the on the left, Matsumoto Kyozo is a wakashu, a male youth, Nakamura Denkuro as a yako, a samurai retainer. This must date to right around 1699, 1700. It's an extremely rare print that captures the excitement of the Kabuki theater at the turn of the 18th century and the gender-bending roles that enticed audiences. And when viewing a print like this, I also remind you, if you have a chance, to go over to the Wrightwood 659 gallery, because an exhibition, a very thought-provoking and groundbreaking exhibition called First Homosexuals. And in fact, there are images, early Japanese images, of wakashu. The setting here in this print is a spring outing to view cherry blossoms. And above the two actors are curtains decorated with their respective crests. On the right is shown, as I mentioned, Denkuro in the role of a feudal retainer, his scowling features, bedammed with you gesturing and ruffian stance, encapsulate the exaggeratedly boisterous aragoto, rough stuff roles for which he became famous. In front of him, Kyōzo delighted his audiences and achieved fame for his sensuous performances as a onagata, a male actor who cross-dressed on stage as a woman. Yet, the scene here captures an even more complex permutation of gender roles, since the kerchief of the wakashu role, it would normally be purple if you saw it on stage, is an attribute of a man playing a female role. But the character, as you can see, represents the role of a wakashu, a male youth attired in feminine garb. In this case, the actor is shown in flamboyant robes, a pair of swords tucked into his sash, but with a woman's hairstyle, not the more vertical top knot of a young man. During this age, such nisei wakashu goto, or imitation male youth roles, enjoyed a surge in popularity, though since prints capturing such poses are actually extremely rare, we must assume audiences were content for wakashu to be wakashu, for boys to be boys on the kabuki stage. We know that Hyōzo traveled from his base in Osaka to perform at the Yamamura Theater in Edo. And over the course of 2 years, he performed with Denkuro. So we can imagine that a print like this was created to promote the seductive appeal of an onagata trained actor on the stage in Osaka. No inscriptions, no texts identifying the artist. We rely on the crests to tell us who the actors are. We, at this stage, cannot identify the actors based on facial representation. We rely on the crests, and then, fortunately, sometimes we are actually given the name of the actor. And of course, the crucial pioneers in actor prints are the Tori school actors. And we have, for instance, in a print that must be 40 Kiyomasa, lacking a signature, but you can see how we know that it's an actor of the Ichikawa family because of the crest. And of course, this is a scene of scattering beans during the Setsubun festival. And of course, it's a perfect scene for this day and age when we want to say oni wa soto, fuku wa uchi, out with the demons and disease of COVID, and bring in good luck and good health. The next print that I would like to show is also a Tori school actor print, mid-18th century. This vertically elongated print, a hashirae, a pillar print, presents a full-length portrait of Segawa Kikunojo, as you see here, Segawa Kikunojo, and this is Kikunojo II, one of the most popular onagata, or male actors of female roles of the mid-18th century. Here he is represented in the popular stock role of Yaoya Oshichi, a greengrocer's daughter, who has fallen in love with a temple page named Kichisaburo. Their tragic story, ending in the deaths of both, was one of the many contemporary scandals popularized by Ihara Saikaku in the celebrated popular novel, Five Women Who Loved Love, Koshoku Gonin Onan, 1686, which inspired dramatic reworkings for kabuki and puppet theaters. Kikunojo II performed the role of Yaoya Oshichi in the 1760s, and both times at the Ichimura Theater in Edo. But because Kichisaburo here is represented as a doll and not as an actor, this tableau should be considered as a depiction of an imaginary performance, a mitate, created for fans of this famous actor of female roles. Oshichi is shown at a tender moment when she takes into her arms a doll of her lover, Kichisaburo, whom she met and fell in love with when she took refuge at his family temple during a fire in Tokyo. And this is all based on actual events. Later, when she was unable to meet him, she deliberately sets another fire with the hope that she can rendezvous again, but she is caught and sentenced to death for arson. Kichisaburo predeceases her by committing suicide. The doll here thus suggests that they cannot meet in person. The actor's stage name is given here. Yoko Roko is the actor's poetry name. So we know that this poem is composed by the actor. Conveniently, it gives us the Nigori Ten. So we know this is Kabuto ni mo, Mune ni omoi ya, Fuji, and we even know it's Bumi, Fuji, Bumi. The feelings in my heart extend even to this doll and enfolded love letters. Well, I don't want to analyze every single poem in detail, but let me just give you a little bit of evidence of how these poems on actor prints operate. The word kabuto refers usually to a warrior's helmet, but it's also a way to refer to a kabuto ningyo, the samurai dolls that were placed on display for Boys' Day on the fifth day of the fifth month. Kichisaburo here does not have a visage, of course, of a fearsome warrior, but is rather represented as an elegantly appointed wakashu, male youth, with a pair of swords tucked into his sash. The phrase Fuji functions as a pivot word. This is one of the techniques I want to familiarize you with. It's a kake kotoba, a pivot word, first as part of the phrase amoya Fuji, which suggests feelings of love folded and tied together, and Fuji Bumi, referring to the Japanese custom of folding letters instead of placing in envelopes. The crest of the folded letters on Kikunojo's costume specifically refers to this role. And in the pleasure quarters, letters sent to a courtesan by a courtesan to her patron, in fact, would have been fully knotted at one end, a signal that the contents are to remain secret till it reaches its intended recipient. The name Goko will be familiar to many people interested in popular Edo culture. You start to see the fashion for this famous onagata of roko kushi, the combs, hair combs, and roko obi, the sashes that you would wear. Or you would even have, most importantly perhaps, is roko cha. That means literally roko tea, but it refers in fact to the greenish brown color. Originally, her costume would have been this greenish brown color, this tea color that became one of the most popular colors of kimono in the Edo period. And those of you who have a chance to go to New York City at the Met right now, we have an exhibition called Kimono Style, and you will be able to see evidence of Edo period costumes that employ this color. Now, there's a lot of complexity in this poetic inscription, but this particular triptych, uncut triptych, perhaps demonstrates the extreme complexity of these inscriptions on prints. 17 syllables doesn't seem like it can contain a lot of information, content, allusion, but let's just work on this one print for a minute to see if we can understand it better. Well, those of you familiar with kabuki of the age realize that the tableau shows six of the most famous kabuki actors of the mid-18th century and playfully depicts them as courtesans and their clients within a reception room of a Yoshiwara brothel. On top of that, each print also highlights a different traditional Japanese musical instrument, as suggested by the term sankyoku in the title cartouche. It's referring to a trio of musical instruments. Kyōka in the title refers to the legend of a male and female pair of birds, each with one eye and one wing, that are destined to always fly together as a joined pair. And over the years, this term came to refer to the deep love of a couple, or even of a courtesan and her patron. And look carefully, and you can see how the artist refers to the idea of a shared wing by having each couple perform a duet, but on a single musical instrument. Of course, all of the actors here are men, but most of them were renowned for their ability to take on the appearance and persona in roles of women or effeminate young men. Even though they're not depicted in any kabuki stage role here, the crests, once again, allow us to identify them. It's a triptych. You have the Migi Hidari reversed from what we would normally think, but this is the way that Japanese triptychs were referred to in pre-modern times. On our right, which is labeled left, is Onoe Kikugoro as a wakashu. Segawa Kikunojo I in the arraignment of Yoshiwara courtesan performs a duo with the former fingering a fiddle-like instrument called a kokyu, while the latter handles the bow. In the center, Nakamura Shisaburo II poses as a Yoshiwara patron fingering the three-string shamisen, the most common instrument of the Yoshiwara brothels, as well as in Kabuki and among geisha, while Arashi Koroku I, his costume as a courtesan, strums the instrument with a plectrum. Finally, on the left, Sanagawa Ichimatsu I takes the role of a young courtesan, gently blowing on a yokubue, a transverse flute, holding it in one hand, while Takinaka Hidematsu I holds the end of the instrument with one hand. The erotic suggestiveness of each vignette was certainly intended by the artist. Now, it's already pretty complicated, isn't it? It's fascinating at the same time. Let's just look at a few of these poems more carefully. It sounds like just a seasonal poem, a 17 syllable seasonal poem. Breezes and spring sunshine make us feel so wonderful when meeting up at Mount Ai. Simple enough. It must have been created for springtime of 1747. All of the poems, all three of the poems, have vernal imagery. The next, there are references to Osugi and Otama, and these are the infamous female street performers who earn their living by sitting on the bench playing shamisen and kokyu. So there's a reference not only to the literary references, but to popular culture as well. And this is they performed at Ainoyama, the hill separating the inner and outer shrines at Ise. Just to show you this is the kind of scene that it's referring to of Osugi and Otama. Now, this was a small hill on a pilgrimage route between the inner and outer shrines of Ise Grand Shrine, known for itinerant musicians, performers, beggars, assorted riffraff, and Osugi and Otama were among the most famous of them. And in the case of this poem, we do have the use of that pivot word, the takekotoba again, because minii, if you take the first characters of the second line and combine minii, of course, means to have a rendezvous. So there is that level of suggestiveness. And then just to quickly go in the second poem, as springtime waters warm, their faces draw near to pluck the shamisen strings. It sounds like a very descriptive poem. Once again, referring to the performers, but Batsi Atari is a double entendre in this context. It, of course, suggests the plucking of the shamisen strings with a plectrum by Osugi and Otama at Mount Ai, but it also has a suggestion of a person being cursed for misbehavior, such as the son neglecting his parents to go out for boarding in a brothel, as the male patrons are shown doing in this print. And then the final poem, still budding flowers, innocent of the bitter encounters of flowers in full bloom, also has a level of Tsubomi no Hana, flowers still in bud, a reference to apprentice courtesan who have yet to see the auguries of the licensed quarters. And they are also making reference once again to Osugi and Otama, who did not experience any pain because they were able to deflect the coins that passersby rudely tossed at them. So without elaborating any further, do you see what appears to be a straightforward, simple, seasonal poem has multiple levels of allusion? And this is what would have been enjoyed and recognized by the people who originally received or bought these prints when they first came out. So I've just shown you examples of the haikai tradition, the 17 syllable verse tradition. That remained an important tradition in Japan. But something happened up in Edo in the Tenmei period in the late 18th century. There was a great revival of kyōka, literally mad poetry, witty poetry, written in five lines of 7, 5, 7, 5, 7, 5, 7, 7 syllables, respectively. Upstart intellectuals like Santo Kyōden, but several others we'll see, they all participated in writing poems. And even the great Danjūrō V, who called himself the poet, gave himself the kyōka poetry name, Hanamichi Surane. And it's playful, self-deprecating reference that he's saying that actually, even though he can't write poetry, even he can't go down the Hanamichi very effectively. So often artists and actors and samurai, they created playful names for themselves, and it disguised their actual identities. And this was one of the important aspects of kyōka of the late 18th century, early 19th century, is everyone could join in: samurai, merchants, artists, actors. And Kubo Shunman was a great intellectual interested in kokugaku, national learning, very talented artist and producer of privately commissioned surimono, talented kyōka poet. When he created a privately published surimono, his portrait did not include an actual picture of the artist. This was going to be the realm of the Katsukawa school artists and then later the Utagawa school artists. So he created a still life. And this is what Kubo Shunman excelled at. And so the still life surimono shows us Ichikawa Danjūrō V with the props and the costume for a shibaraku role. And so this is the way that Kubo Shunman depicts the artist Danjūrō V. And go 20 years later, just to show you how you have the kyōka movement being promoted by artists such as Hokusai and also Kunisada, Hokusai's pupil, such as Gakute. You see that the Kyoka movement was further promoted by the distribution of Kyoka Surimono, deluxe privately published prints. And here we capture two poets. Well, one you know very well is the Shidaime Sanju is Danjūrō VII himself. And that is what his handwriting actually looked like when you look on the fan. And then Jingairo Kiyosumi was one of the great Kyoka masters of the age. He was also an ardent fan of Kabuki and an ardent fan of Danjūrō VII. And his poetry always was centered on Danjūrō VII. So we even have the poem by Danjūrō VII just talking about how much he appreciates his fans. And then you have Kiyosumi saying that it would be hard for foreigners to see the Danjūrō craze. And that's what was happening in actor prints, in Kyoka movement. There was an entire fan club, the Mimasu Ren, was dedicated to promoting Danjūrō VII. So foreigners could never see the Danjūrō craze or the peak of Mount Fuji in a New Year's dream. It's national pride, not only with Mount Fuji, which is a common symbol of that pride, but they're even including Danjūrō VII. So let me move to a remarkable portrait. Omezo I, he's shown in a formal pose wearing a persimmon brown ceremonial kimono, kamishimo. And as many of you know very well, he was a very famous actor of the time. He was a leading man, a tachiyaku. He was known for his penetrating eyes, his distinctive hooked nose. And this work was created by Kunisada in 1833, the signature style, the seal lineup. And Omezo died in 1833. So that all fits perfectly, the style and signature for this to be a work of 1833. But how perplexing it was to see Danjūrō's own inscription on it. This was a little bit, caused a little bit of consternation for me when I was trying to acquire it, because the last thing in the world I wanted was to have a genuine Kunisada painting with a fake Danjūrō inscription, because I knew Danjūrō's handwriting. I've shown you just one example already, but this is not Danjūrō's handwriting of 1833. It didn't match up at all. But doing a little homework, reading the inscription a little bit better, you can see that this was inscribed by the great Danjūrō VII when he was 66 years old. It was inscribed probably for Omezo's 27th death anniversary, and that's when Danjūrō VII, or Ebizo V, in his very dynamic, idiosyncratic, cursive calligraphy, he was eulogizing his mentor. referring to him by the name Sōdai.
And
as you see here, from the time of my youth until I became a serious actor, I knew the joys of the path of acting in the Ichikawa lineage and never lost enthusiasm for the aragoto style, the rough stuff style, and acting methods that should last forever. For a long while, he made it his duty to lend me support from the depths of his heart. Ichikawa Sōdai, another name for Omezo. So this is an example of a poetic inscription in the hand of a great actor, and Kunisada and the Utagawa school would go on for years and years creating both commercial prints and privately published surimono with poetic inscriptions honoring the lineage of all the Danjūrō of previous generations up to Danjūrō the Seventh, who was the current hero of the stage. And prints such as this showing Danjūrō the First in the inset, looking at Danjūrō the Seventh. This kind of print created for the poetry clubs, created for the Mimasuren or the Gogawa, would become so important. And here, a print having Ichikawa Danjūrō as Mongaku Shonin. And then the figure on the bottom is, the figure on the top is actually not Koshiro, as you see in some catalogs. It's actually Danjūrō the Fifth as Fudo Myō. And once again, the poem is referring to the beginning of spring. It's an auspicious gift to send to fellow members of the poetry club. And so it's just a poem of greeting, but it's by Umenoya. And Umenoya, and those of you who study Kunisada or Kuniyoshi know that he was a very wealthy poet and a great fan of kabuki, and commissioning fabulous surimono, such as we see here. And of course, Fudo Myō was the Buddhist deity worshipped by Danjūrō and the Ichikawa clan. 1828, the famous Danjūrō play is performing as in the Adate Kurabe Okuni Kabuki, and the dastardly samurai Niki Danjō is transformed himself into a rat. He played this in 1828, and this is just the moment when Arajishi Otokonosuke is about to pummel the rat on its forehead. The rat bids a hasty retreat through a trapdoor and afterwards is transformed into his original human form. In the performances, he is seen rising from the stage with the scroll still clenched in his teeth, and he escapes later through the Hanamichi with a fearless grin. And so this diptych of surimono captures that moment. And we see in illustrated books that Kunisada would present the same scene for this book that was created by the Mimasuren, the poetry group that supported, that was a fan club for Danjūrō when he was in Osaka. And we even see that, we see the artist himself, Kunisada, contributing a poem. And this is when we have Danjūrō going down to Osaka. He's away for just a moment while at the season's opening, his son, the reigning Ebizo, is lauded by all of Edo. And this print captures Danjūrō when he went down to Osaka, 1830, and he did a coxing scene, and he's subduing a tiger appropriately for the year of the tiger. And this is a segue to our move to Osaka. And let me begin with, once again, a painting with a manuscript inscription by the great Rikan, the Arashi Saburo, or Kichi Saburo II, as Prince Koretaka. He was the most famous of Osaka actors. He's shown as Prince Koretaka. Character is based on an actual member of the late 19th century Heian court, and he's always represented, though, more heroically in kabuki plays with the sword and grand costume. He's posed on a raised mat with colored borders associated with royalty, and he leans on a black lacquer armrest topped with a luxurious tiger pelt, and decorated with the tachibana, the mandarin orange patterns, referring to the actor's newly acquired breast. But the poem by Rikan, you can see his signature here, the Sakura Shiru, this is a kanji, ono ni, minori in kanji, minori no, wakaba, ha, leaf, young leaves, wakaba, kana. As cherry blossoms scatter at Ono, new leaves will appear, just as Buddha teaches. So it's the idea that you come to the end of your life, but you will be reborn in the Pure Land. This must have been created as a memorial portrait for this great actor. It was done a year or two before he died, but he was anticipating his death, and he actually was in retirement in Ono at this time. So a very moving memorial portrait with inscription by, almost serving as a death poem by the actor himself. And to conclude this section of my talk, I would just like to show you different permutations of how poetic inscriptions were used on Osaka prints. And this will be perhaps maybe a inspiration to do further work on the wonderful inscriptions in the McCormick collection. But even today, when I was looking at some of the inscriptions on the prints, sometimes it was just the name of the actor in this dramatic calligraphy. And in this case, we just have, we think, I don't know who Suihendo, perhaps a fan of the actor, but he just praises the actor. He probably commissioned the print. Even at first glance, he's so captivating, truly a skilled actor whose technique, it's true, makes him seem so dashing. And, you know, of course, Nakamura Utaimon the third was that great all-around actor, Kaneru Yaksha, the Osaka stage. He could play any type of role, male or female, hero or villain. And here he's shown as the townsman turned samurai, Inanoya Hambei. Show you another type of a print that you might have. You have this kind of poetic inscription, and one of them is just by the actor himself, and it's commemorating taking a new stage name. So that's another function of the poem. So you can have the fans or the actor himself saying thank you to his fan club. And one of my favorite Osaka prints ever made, a very, very little known artist, Shunshi. There were three artists actually that used the same name, Shunshi, and he was, we're sure that he studied under Hokushu. And all of his known works are active portraits, but we suspect that he was not a professional artist, but rather a fan of Kabuki, who created these works as an avocation. This does not have a poetic inscription, but I just want to remind us of how, even when inscribing the actors' names, you create another dimension to the enjoyment of the composition. I found this particularly touching when I studied this a bit further, because this print seems to unintentionally become a memorial portrait of Arashi Koroku the Fourth. It's commemorating a farewell performance that he wanted to give, but which never occurred. He's shown here defiantly posed as the female bandit Hote Ochi with the shakuhachi bamboo flute, pipe, the kiseru cloth purse associated with such roles, the head note and verse by the actor's wife. Isn't that interesting? The actor's wife wrote the poem expressing how distraught she is by the unexpected passing of her husband. So the print had been made, supposed to celebrate his farewell performance, and he didn't make it to his own farewell performance. It's hard to make out the poem on this print, but it does show the great, the second generation Arashi Rikan playing a role inspired by the famous medieval warrior and swordsman Miyamoto Musashi. It's by the actor himself again. Then we have another generation of the Utaimon. This is Utaimon the Fourth in a dynamic role. Another fabulous Osaka print. And I think this is also such a fabulous print that shows Arashi, Tokusaburo as the female gallant, the Onadate Ohashi. And Tokusaburo was famous for his performances as a young woman, Waka Onagata. Here he's representing the role of Onadate, the chivalrous woman Ohashi, who's defended the weak and oppressed, and the weak and oppressed against abusive samurai, and they're popularized in literature on the Kabuki stage as champions of the townspeople. The 17-syllable hokku by the actor himself, just the tachi and kana, tachi, and this is hana, tachibana no kaori wa yomo, yomo ni, ne, ne kau, nari. We pray that the fragrance of the mandarin orange blossoms will spread in all directions. So the actor is just saying, please, my fans, may I have great success as well this season. It's a little bit late for Halloween, but I just want to encourage anyone who works with Osaka prints to pay more attention to Enjaku. It's often difficult to see his signature. It's so highly cursive, and it's often on a dark background. But this is just a reminder that another function of poetic inscriptions on Osaka prints, as well as Edo prints, are for memorial portraits. And you can see the colors and the use of the symbolism that this is fans who are commemorating the death of a beloved actor. Now, I would like to conclude my talk in the way I started, with a print that has no poetic inscription, no identification of the actor's name. And this is a print that perhaps you all know. It's the Turtle Fun Wonderful Wonderful around 1848. As we discussed this afternoon during the viewing, there was a sumptuary ban on creating identifiable portraits of courtesans and actors. Though, of course, by this time, the entire tradition of nigaoe, of likeness portraits, as continued by Katsukawa and Utagawa school artists, had been firmly ingrained, and then the Osaka print artists were drawing on this tradition. And audiences knew how to pick out the various artists just by the codes of likenesses that had been created. And it's wonderful here that if you look carefully, even though there are no names to the artists, you can actually sometimes make out crests in the shells. And it's almost though as we're going back to the initial image that I started with, where you have to identify the artist by the crests, but also these faces were recognizable to fans. But if we look carefully, we do see one calligraphic interpolation, the character for Kotobuki. Felicitations for longevity and good health. And of course, we would all like to drink to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. Would you be willing?
Oh, of course.
And I just would like to first thank our sponsors, the Center for East Asia Studies, Andrew Center for the Art of East Asia, and the Smart Museum of Art, and the Franke Institute for the Humanities, all at the University of Chicago. So thank you so much, and especially thank the staff of CEAS for their incredible help and support. So with that, the floor is open both for our in-person and online listeners.
George.
So you played an image of a, thank you. You displayed a wonderful image of a wonderful Shunman, Danjūrō, but not himself, his accoutrement. And if you could put that back on the screen again.
Go right back to
all of it. There. So just as it left the screen, I noticed that the
That's Roberta calling.
I noticed that the crest on the box is the carp swimming upstream, is everyday moment. In as opposed to, in addition to the Mimasu
The Still Life Surimono by Shunman Hokusai students used to represent the props associated with a particular kabuki play or role are tremendous. Hokusai, in fact, created a handful of kabuki portraits of scenes from kabuki, but in comparison with his prolific output, absolutely minuscule. They are wonderful prints. It's as though Hokusai was saying, I don't care if Kunisada says that I can't do actor surimono, but he just did a few. His pupils were, I think, terrified to go against the monopoly that the Utagawa school had on likeness portraits. It is a wonderful, so of 1796, relatively. It's a group of Shunman Surimono and Egoyomi that we acquired, a whole cluster of them, and this was among them.
Thank you so much for that wonderful overview of inscription on character prints. I'm really intrigued by the prints that capture the handwriting of the actors. And there's such a difference between the prints that reproduce the handwriting and the actual presumed handwriting, you know, inscriptions by the actor. And so looking at Danjūrō VII, I think you were making the point that on a painting, the handwriting differs because the actor is older. But I wonder if you have thoughts on how you see the handwriting reproduced on prints, and do you think that the handwriting for, let's say, Danjūrō VII on prints, especially commercial prints, is really mimicking or faithful to his handwriting, or does it even matter? I mean, when somebody's acquiring a print, if you have an idea that it's his handwriting, that might be all that's necessary.
What I feel was happening is that actors were supposed to have a distinctive hand. So they practiced, in fact, their handwriting. Someone like Danjūrō was so busy, I am quite sure that he had a secretary who knew how to create his handwriting. And then the publishers and his publicists would make sure that when it was translated into the woodblock print medium, that it was stylized and appeared extremely skilled. But Danjūrō could, we have many examples of his manuscript handwriting from, let's say, 1833. And if you're comparing against those on the Kunisada painting, you're completely. I, in fact, was so worried about this, I sent this to a few kabuki specialists in Japan. And I said, is there any possibility that this is actually Danjūrō's handwriting the year before he died? And this is exceptional. This never happens with Heian or Kamakura calligraphy. The specialist wrote back the next day, said, absolutely, this is Danjūrō's real handwriting, his own handwriting, not a secretary's, of the when he was 66 years old. So that was reassuring. We bought the painting.
John, isn't there a painting in the Weber collection, a fan painting of Danjūrō that is inscribed by Danjūrō? I don't know what that was. Danjūrō V.
Yep.
So that would be a known handwriting.
Yes. We have, but that is a case where you can have, it was very carefully thought out. So what's more interesting is to get the letters, or when he's at doing an impromptu work. And we can know, and Danjūrō the Seventh was such a celebrity. We know his handwriting well. Danjūrō the Fifth actually had a little bit more of intervention on.
Thank you for such an interesting talk, John. I wanted to ask about the shading of the prints. Do you see any difference between the Osaka prints and the Tokyo or the Edo prints?
That's a good, good question. We're showing some especially, well, I think enjakus are just so fascinating. I can't make any generalization. Perhaps somebody in the audience will know better. And I know there've been a number of articles published on shinie, but even in this particular actor's case, there were so many, fans commissioning shinie, even within, for one actor, one place, the range of quality of the shinie is just vast. So I assume, and I think that happened both in Edo and Osaka, you could have absolutely extravagant memorial portraits, and then others are perfunctory. But I don't know if anyone in the audience knows about if there's any conspicuous differences. Do you, have you seen?
I don't, but I'm interested in looking it up now.
Since you have this, you talked a lot about how poetry creates these different layers of appreciating Kabuki and the characters, and I think this is a great way in which you have an object portrait, which is actually something we think of as a modern phenomenon. So I wonder if this. Because it fits in with the larger genre of still like so-called still like kabuki, I wonder if there is a way that this object portrait, if you can call it such, sheds light on this larger genre of still like kabuki and the poetry and pictorial references that we see in it. And with this.
What I can say is that one of the reasons I became so fascinated with surimono in general was because of the experimentation with still life in Edo surimono. Now, as I was perusing the McCormick collection on the online database, what really caught my eye were some still life surimono produced Shijo school artists in Osaka that are so strongly represented in the McCormick collection. And that's also an interesting area of investigation. I think people don't realize when they think of Japanese prints that there is this early manifestation of still life, both in actor-related or kabuki-related imagery. And then, of course, think of all the shunman and hokusai surimono series that are created on still life themes. They're actually radical in their innovation in terms of world art history. And they're neglected because people weren't aware of surimono as much as the hokusai and hiroshige landscapes, for instance, or the typical actor portraits. So it's an interesting area for any students who are interested to pursue.
Yeah, Thank you. I think that in a way, when I first learned about them and I couldn't yet read the poetry, even especially if they're called still life, you tend to associate them with your being still life. But then once I became able to read the poetry and I saw how you definitely showed that different words will pop out at you and will recombine in different ways, to create double meanings, like in the poem with the Ayama, then it seems to me that the objects in the surimono also help to kind of capture that moving relationship between the different words and every different poem and between the different layers of the poem, if it's not happening or something like that.
What students should be encouraged to pursue in their own future research is the way that artists like Hokusai and Shunman could transform the meaning of the poem that was submitted to them through very clever type of visual play corresponding to the word play. The other thing to keep in mind is that the still life tradition in Japan probably grew out of poetry contests that had the idea of the takara awase, where you had the theme was decided by all of these interesting objects that were brought together, often antiquarian objects. And this is the root of the still life surimono. And it's completely separate from the Western still life tradition.
Thank you.
Thank you for the talk. I'm curious about the relation between text and language, and whether there was any convention or logic where you put a name or where you put a poem, where you put long a poem, or artists were free to experiment. Or, for example, you always had to have the name of an actor in that right corner, or it was a part of where the artist could also surprise somebody. Think, oh, this is unusual. The poem is written on the screen at the very beginning, yeah? Because sometimes I see the inscriptions are above, sometimes below, sometimes on costumes, sometimes in the background. And it's good that the part of the artistic experience together, the name can be on the left,
There are conventions that you have to stick to, but on some of these fabulous prints, you can see that the calligraphic dimension becomes an important part of the composition. So especially the poetry can be cursive. But on so many of the Hirosada album prints, even the name of the actor can be turned into calligraphic experimentation. So there were no limits. And in fact, we often enjoy the prints where the artist has violated tradition and done something experimental. And that personal dimension, that dimension of individuality by making the calligraphy distinctive, is something special. When you often you see on surimono produced in Edo and in Kamigata, the calligraphy is that of a professional calligrapher. It's very regular. And then when you find a surimono that has the idiosyncratic handwriting of a poet like Rokujuen or someone, those are particularly enjoyable and special. So when they break the rules, they did it on purpose, and it creates something that we're 100 or 200 years later, we actually can partake in that enjoyment that the original recipients had.
Thank you very much. Any further questions? Great.
Thank you for the fascinating talk. I have a question about how the Osaka fans, if they have specific channels that they went through to publish print, because I was thinking of the one, I think it was the one of Kuroku, and then the one that had the poem on it, and that's not by a fan, but I thought it was very interesting to kind of include those very personal elements in it. If you could talk a little bit about what kind of channels they went through to have these prints.
No, I don't know in detail the logistics of this, but I think once again there were poetry circles that served as de facto fan clubs, and then the poetry masters of the day in both Edo in Osaka were the intermediaries with the artists and publishers. So the poetry, if you have a couple poems on a print, and one is by the master and one is by a poetry master and one is by a lesser known poet, actually you can be pretty sure that that lesser known poet paid a fee to his poetry master to get his poem published in deluxe format on a wonderful actor portrait, an actor who he was a fan of. And so I think this is the kind of dynamic that was at work. I showed you Utayoshi's a print of Danjūrō in Osaka in 1830, Danjūrō with a tiger. And the publisher there, the producer was Taniseiko, who was perhaps the most talented surimono producer that ever lived. And he was based in Osaka for a good part of his career. And I think in that case, some of these producers, Kubo Shunman did this as well. He was a poet, I mentioned. He was a literary arbiter. He was a scholar. He was a talented artist. But he was also in charge of a surimono production studio. And so he had his network of poets that would come to him, and then he would arrange either to do his own surimono, but you also see Kubo Shunman's stamp on Utagawa school surimono. So Shunman was one of these networkers who I'm sure took a fee from poets who wanted to be published. So I think that kind of dynamic is going on.
Thank you. Hi, thank you so much for such a fantastic talk. I have a question, a curiosity about this kind of pivot word that you mentioned. I believe in the context of the local comb and obi and tea and such, and whether you could return to that and kind of elaborate a bit on how that's
the term take kotoba, actually, for anyone who has studied the history of Japanese poetry, going back to the classical tradition of Heian period waka, of court poetry, the kake kotoba was one of the fundamental techniques used in 31 syllable court poetry. Now, when you get up into the 18th and 19th century, one of the things that distinguishes kyōka, so-called mad poetry, from traditional waka, is that it uses more wordplay and techniques such as kake kotoba to the extreme. And so this became an element of kyōka. Now, it also is part of the haikai tradition, and all of this can be all of the haikai poets knew the basho tradition, the 17th century Basho tradition. It dominated the subsequent history of the haikai tradition in Edo. There were independent teachers that tried to diverge from the Basho style. So it's interesting, you know, even the use of the cutting word ya to break up a line. It's just for emphasis, whether you represent it by an exclamation point and then to end with that kana. This is coming right out of the Basho tradition. So all of these conventions, all of these techniques, this poetics of haikai or of kyōka is drawing on earlier traditions. Not anything radically new, but just the extent to which you use it actually changed during the late Edo period.
Thank you very much. So with that, I think we will conclude. Please join me in giving Johnny one of her medical talks. Please join us for tomorrow's program over in the Frankie Institute of Humanities if you're able. And I'd like to invite you all to a reception which will take place one door down in the lounge. Thank you, everyone.